Okay, go ahead. Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. We're going to rejoice and we're going to be glad in it this morning. Are you glad you're here?
Amen.
Amen. Before we go into the word, let's pray this morning. Father, we just come to you right now in the name of your Son, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that your word says we're two or three gathered together in your name, in your character, and in your authority, you're in the midst of us. So I thank you that you're here. Minister to us this day. I thank you, even as we've honored you, we've praised and we've worshiped you, that your presence is in this house, already preparing our hearts and our minds to receive the uncorruptible word, Lord, that it would be grafted deep upon our hearts today. I ask you, Holy Spirit, that you're the one who teaches, that you're the one who brings understanding, and you're the one who brings the revelation of the word which you authored to us. I thank you that the eyes of our understanding are open, that our spiritual ears are open so we can hear and perceive what the Spirit says to us today. I thank you for your anointing is upon the word, for it produces life and change in us in the name of Jesus, Father. I thank you for even the growth among your people. If you agree this morning, shout amen. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. We've been talking about learning from the life of Daniel. How many of you know Daniel? How's he been? I want to just do kind of a quick review before I go into section two. We learned last week that Daniel was a man who was determined not to defile himself. Remember? He was a man that would not stain himself with compromise. Say compromise. He would not walk one day in the world and one day in the spirit. He was a man who was after God. There was no compromise in his life whatsoever. And because of that, the divine favor of God was upon his life, and God was able to raise him up through the governmental ranks. He had favor in the sight of the king. Amen. He was able to decipher the king's dreams. You know, he was used by God to even change that land. And because he was a man who wouldn't compromise, because he was a man who honored God, he lived above accusation. Accusation is a terrible thing. Have you ever been accused of something? I've been accused of many things. You know, and when the accusations are usually false, well then, you know, we recognize it right away. Sometimes God will use someone to accuse us of something that's true. You know, well, what are you talking about? Well, has your boss ever rebuked you because you're constantly late or you take off 2 days a week all the time? You know, God will use leaders to rebuke us, to chastise us, to perfect us so we could be people who live above accusation. We found out that Daniel was not negligent in his life. The word negligent, we learned last week, the word from Noah Webster means careless. He wasn't accustomed to admit to the things he ought to do. Many times we as believers, we have the Christian buffet going on, you know? Oh, I like a little bit of the blessing. Oh, let me take some increase. Let me take a new job. Fasting? No, not for me. And we can't live this life of pick and choose what we want. Either we believe the whole counsel and the whole gospel of God or we don't. And we being people of the word that know that the word produces this overcoming faith that we live in and we speak in to have the victory, well, we can't compromise our morals or our beliefs. We can't pick and choose. Turn to your neighbor and say, stop picking. Don't pick on that. Amen? That word also being negligent meant denoting habitual carelessness. Daniel wasn't. He wasn't negligent. But sometimes in our lives, we form these habits that causes us to walk in a place of having less integrity in our life. You know? And then we back it up with excuses. You know? We kind of justify why we can't change. When we do that, we stop God from working because God never violates your will. If you don't want to change, God's not going to change you. Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, I got that. Right? But he wasn't negligent. The opposite of negligent was diligent. Daniel was a man of diligence, and we too need to be like Daniel, that are people of diligence. Say diligence. What is diligence? It means to be steady in application to business. It means to be constant in effort or exertion to accomplish what's undertaking. Amen? God has called you. God has gifted you. God has given you a purpose in this life, and you need to walk in that life to the fullness, having the victory over the things that the devil has tried to keep you bound in. Being free of fear, being free of depression, being free of addictions, and totally surrendering your life to God has to be key. Amen? God doesn't want a 99% Christian. He wants a 100% Christian, right? Like we said last week, he didn't defile himself with the things of the world. He didn't entertain what seemed to be logical, didn't seem to entertain the things that seemed right to so many people under Nebuchadnezzar. He knew his God, and he knew what his God called him. Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, do you know your God? That word diligent also means steadily applied. You see, in our walk with God, we need to be diligent. We need to steadily be applying the word to our life. We need to be speaking the word over our lives and over our families. We need to be decreeing a thing in our lives. We need to walk by faith and not by sight. Walk by what God says and not what feelings dictate. Walk by what God says and not what government says. Amen? Like the Hebrew National commercial, we answer to a higher authority. Amen. And we're going to see that today, by the way. So Daniel was a man of diligence. Open your Bible to Daniel chapter 6. And I'm going to kind of read through this whole chapter, but we're going to stop along the way. Let me just grab my water. Sorry I stepped out of the frame, guys. I didn't go too far. I'm back. When you're there, say amen. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 satraps, to be over the whole kingdom, and over these three governors, of whom Daniel was one, that the satraps might give account to them, so that the king would suffer no loss. Verse 3. Then this Daniel distinguished himself above the governors and the satraps, because he had an excellent spirit. Daniel had an excellent spirit. Daniel did everything in excellence. Say excellence. He presented himself well. He was a man that what he said, he did. He was a man who was purposed. He had an excellent spirit. And because of that, you know, when you walk in God's perfection, let's say, when you're walking in that place where you're not living in sin, but you're righteous, you're set apart, you're uncompromising in your walk with God, you're bearing fruit, people are getting saved, people are getting healed, it makes the other people look less, right? So it causes people to become jealous, right? And that's what happened with these other guys. They said, look at this guy. He's so perfect. Who does he think he is? You know, you ever get that? Oh, what do you think, you're like Miss Goody Two-Shoes? You know? Yeah, exactly. Because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king gave thought to setting him over the whole realm. You see, when you walk in excellence, you will be promoted. When you walk in excellence, you will be promoted. When you live with an excellent spirit, you will have promotion in your life, because God is the God of promotion. Your boss has nothing to do with your promotion. God just uses him. Just like God might even use your boss to demote. Well, I don't want to hear that. Well, if you're not living in excellence, why should you have the benefits of someone who is? I can feel your pain. Right? So we have to choose to be excellent in God. So the governors and the satraps sought to find some charge against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could not find charge, and they could not find a fault, because he was faithful. Turn to your neighbor and say, Daniel was faithful. He was a man who was faith-filled and faithful. He was a man that knew his God and he knew how to serve his God properly. He did his serving of God with excellence. He was faithful to God. Amen? Let's continue. Nor was there any error or fault found in him. Isn't that great? Now, Daniel was not God, right? Daniel was a man. Daniel was a human being. Daniel could be sitting right here in the congregation with us today. He was just like you and me, but he chose to live a life of excellence. In order to live a life of excellence, you need to be excited about who you are and what you're doing. Because when you're not excited about who you are or what you're doing, you really don't give a poop. You don't care. You know, Pastor Anthony used to say, you know, to people, you know, you're very sloppy. He would always say it to me. But not just to me because, you know, I'm not a knee freak. But in the house and in the ministries, he would say, you need to shape it up. This is very sloppy. Coming late and leaving early, very sloppy. Vacations and the pleasures of this life, more important than coming out to pray and fast, very sloppy. You need to tighten up. You need to tighten up. And when you're excited about God, you know what? It's very easy to do. When you're not excited about God and you don't have this zealous relationship that we've been talking about having this great zeal before God, you know what? People just could care less. They come, they do their obligation before God, and they think God is well pleased. God is not well pleased with the lack of excellence because it's a lack of integrity. Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, I should have stayed at home. No. Rebuke those words. Amen? Right? But they couldn't find anything wrong with this Daniel. The only thing they knew that they could use against him was his own belief. His commitment to the law of God. His commitment to being obedient to the word of God. That's the only thing that they could use against him was his devotion to God. Amen? So in order to use it against him, they passed the law. They knew Daniel was a man of prayer. And they said, that's it. No more prayer. We're passing a law. No more prayer. Right? They consulted together to establish a royal statute to make a firm decree that whoever petitions any god or man for 30 days, except the king, they shall be cast into the lion's den. Right? Now, O king, establish a decree and sign it in writing so that it cannot be changed. And he did that. In verse 10, it says this, now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went home. And he put on Dr. Phil. And then Oprah. And he filled himself up with the counsel of this world. No. He went home. And when he got home, he went to his upper room. Say upper room. Which means he didn't go to his place of comfort. He went to a secret place. He went to a place where there was no distraction. He went to the upper room. And he had his window open towards Jerusalem. And he knelt down on his knees 3 times that day. And he prayed. And he gave thanks before his God, as was his custom since the early days. In other words, he's been doing this since he's a child. Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, sounds like you. Daniel prayed in secret, but he did not keep it secret that he was a man of prayer. Amen. He prayed in secret, but it was no secret to everyone outside. They all knew that his integrity and his excellence was directly connected to his connection with God. Turn to your neighbor and say, God. Right? He was a committed man who was committed to prayer. How committed was he? Notice that it was after he knew the law was made against him, quite frankly, against praying to God was signed and put into effect, that he continued to pray just as he always did. You see, like I did in the teaching a couple years ago about walking in the authority of God, governmentally, we are to obey the laws of this land, except if they're contrary to what God says. Amen? So he went home and he prayed. He knew it was against the law, but he did it anyway. Instead of staging a protest, instead of getting 100 people together to picket, instead of burning cars, well, burning chariots, he went home and prayed because he didn't react in the carnal mind, and he didn't react according to flesh, and he didn't get vengeful, and he didn't, you know, he didn't resort to natural means of bringing change. For a Christian to get involved in all this mess right now that's going on, to go out and protest and go march and do all this stuff, you're wasting your time. These things only incite people's flesh. And we are not supposed to be people of flesh. We're supposed to be people who will get on our face before God and intercede for our nation, intercede for our leaders, intercede for the peace and the unity in this nation. That's your gifting. That's your calling, to call upon the name of the Lord. So not only will you be saved, but those you're interceding for will be saved too. That the blindest will fall off their eyes and they would see the truth of what's going on. Amen? Amen. Protest, they just make headlines. They don't bring change. Amen. They don't bring change. Prayer changes everything. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's time to pray. All right, sound like Carter Collin. Know what I'm talking about is... Anyway, so instead of staging a protest, he prayed. Verse 11, then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Say his God. Prayer was an expression of his personal devotion to dependency upon God. How dependent upon God are you? Your prayer life will let you know how dependent upon God you are. Because we make petitions and we make our requests known unto God in prayer through supplication and thanksgiving. We go to God and we stand on behalf of people who can't stand for themselves, that God would heal them, that God would deliver them, that God would save them. So prayer is very important. Prayer has to be the number one foundational thing in our life next to knowing God through the Word of God. You can't have a relationship with God if you're not reading the Word and praying. Amen. It doesn't work. You can't have one without the other. Right? Amen. Complain to the manufacturer. Right? So prayer was an expression of his personal devotion to dependency upon his God. Notice it says that he gave thanks to his God in verse 10, and that he was making supplications to his God. So it wasn't just a random God, it was his personal God. God was very real to Daniel, and God was very personal to Daniel. I mean, after all, look what God did in Daniel's life. Amen? He went from being a slave, basically, taken prisoner, brought into this strange land under this strange king, and God raised him up to be part of their government. Amen? So Daniel devoted specific time to pray. There was a consistency in his prayer. It says he prayed three times that day, as he's been doing since his youth. He prays three times a day. Three times a day he prays. And I'm sure the types of prayers he prayed wasn't, Lord bless me, good day. It wasn't drive-by prayer. It was on his face prayer. It was intercession and supplication. Now, why do you think he prayed three times a day? Most likely he did it because he was obedient to the prayer that King Solomon made when he dedicated the temple. When he made the dedication of the temple in, where is it? In Kings, I believe. In the prayer, he said that the people would come, and when they would pray and worship God, they would face and lift their hands towards the temple. And then he went on in his prayer to say, if foreigners were going to pray and worship to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they too would face the temple. So he opened up his window in obedience to the prayer that King Solomon said. You see, that means Daniel knew his word, people. And he looked out the window and he faced Jerusalem and he prayed. So he was a man of prayer and he's a man that knew the word of God. Good stuff. There was consistency in his prayer. Psalms 55, verse 16 and 17 says this, "As for me, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. Evening, morning, and at noon, I will pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice." The Living Bible says it this way, "But I will call upon the Lord to save me, and he will. I will pray morning, noon, and night, pleading aloud with God, and he will answer." Even Jesus taught us in Luke chapter 18 that we should always pray. Say always. The Amplified Bible says, "Jesus told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not to turn coward." They are always to pray and not turn coward. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Are you a coward?" And the word coward, don't faint, don't lose heart, and don't give up. You see, Jesus was trying to express was always pray and don't be fearful. Don't be a coward. What is a coward? Someone who's afraid. Right? The word cower means to hide in a corner because of fear. Right? We are not to be people of fear. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Fear not." Fear is the direct opposite and the direct direction of faith. If we are people of faith, there is no room for fear. What Jesus was saying, you need to always pray and always pray in faith. Don't lose heart. Don't be a coward. Don't give up. Stand strong in faith and stand according to the principles that God has given you. Not being afraid to speak the word and pray the word and decree the word. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So in order to bear fruit, it must be in faith. We can't come to God and expect God to do things through our reasoning and our logic. I shared years ago that the reason why man fell was because of reasoning. The enemy came and reasoned with Eve. Reasoning is a terrible thing unless we're operating through the mind of Christ. And if we're operating through the mind of Christ, well, Jesus doesn't have fear. Jesus isn't a coward. Jesus speaks the truth in love and sometimes in strong rebuke. We like the love part. So we need to know that when we're praying in faith. We can't come to God with this reasoning and logic mentality, an intellectual gospel, if you would, and question everything. If God said to do it, or if your leaders say to do it, you don't go, "Yeah, what if, yeah, but. There's no faith in that, and that doesn't produce anything but more fear. We need to be people who know our God. Turn to your neighbor and say, "I know." You agree? Shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5:17 that we're to pray without ceasing. Non-stop prayer. How many of you like a non-stop flight? Non-stop prayer. How many of you like prayers with a bunch of interruptions? You don't seem to get much done. And the devil is the master of mass distraction, you know. As soon as you want to get to the place and you know you need to pray, you're going to sit down, you're going to pray, the phone's going to ring. Someone's going to knock on the door. The kids are going to start crying. You know, whatever. The devil will do whatever he can to distract you from your relationship with God. He just wants you not to be excellent. He wants you to be a poor testimony of the kingdom of God. He wants people to have an accusation against you. Oh, you're one of those Christians. You don't want that, right? I don't want that. The Amplified Bible says we are to be unceasing in prayer, praying perseveringly. Right? Now, we also see that Daniel, when he prayed with thanksgiving. Say thanksgiving. He prayed with thanksgiving. Philippians 4, verse 6 says, "Do not fret." Again, don't have fear. Or don't have any anxiety about anything. You know, fear is probably one of the biggest thieves in Christianity today. It leaves Christians paralyzed. And you know, especially through the Victorious Overcomer Support Group, I've had people over the years say, "Pastor, please pray that God takes my fear away." Well, in the scripture, with the exception of the spirit of fear, fear is never taken away. God gives us the grace to overcome fear. And the way you overcome fear is to have your mind renewed instead of looking at all the negatives into all the positives of what God promised. Because fear is just perverted faith. Fear is believing the bad report before anything's even happened. Faith is believing the good report before anything's even happened. I mean, of course, when we take it and we believe in faith, we claim it, we speak it, we decree it, it's done, it's ours, and then it'll manifest. But in our heart, it's already manifested because when we pray, we believed we received it. And then we have it. Right? Mark 11. Do not fret or have any anxiety about anything, but in every circumstance and in everything, by prayer and petition or definite request, with thanksgiving, continue to make your wants known to God. You see, we need to mix thanksgiving with our prayer. I said a few weeks ago back in Bible college, Pastor Charles Nieman taught us something, and I'm quoting it to you this day. He said, thanksgiving is the track that faith carries its mighty load. When we have a thankful heart and when we mix thanksgiving into our requests, it is proof to God you already believed it as you're asking it. Lord, I thank you that Aunt Mary is healed, even though in the natural she's laying up in a hospital bed. I thank you because I've sent your word to her. According to Psalm 107 and 20, sent the word, healed her, delivered her out of all destruction. I sent it, so she's healed. I thank you, Lord, that she is the healed of the Lord. And it becomes forever settled in our heart because his word is forever settled. Amen? Fear goes, well, I don't know. I don't know. What if? Oh, what if? What if God didn't hear my prayer? You have no faith. Right? Jesus rebuked the disciples. Come on, guys. Where's your faith? Rise up, men of God. Rise up, women of God. Rise up, youths of God. Amen. Notice that Daniel had that particular place, that particular place to pray. When you pray, do you have a secret place? Do you have a particular place? The King James says a prayer closet. Some translations say a prayer room. Do you have that place where you can cut yourself off of maybe three times a day? To seek God. Maybe you should. Maybe you should look into it. When he prayed, he knelt. He got down on his knees and he prayed. Now we know that God can answer your prayer no matter where you are. You could be driving in your car. You could be hanging off a cliff by one arm. Jesus, save me. Oh, you didn't kneel, you're dead. Doesn't work like that, right? But there is something about posturing yourself before God on your knees. I'm not saying thou must pray on thy knees. It doesn't say that. But there is an act of humility and maybe even in some instances brokenness before God where I'm going to come and honor him and even revere him and have the fear of the Lord for him. Amen. Instead of just being sloppy about it, you know? Because when you walk in integrity with an excellent spirit, you are very precise and very determined about your methods of getting things done. Amen? Are you glad you came this morning? I'm glad I came this morning. Daniel prayed three times facing Jerusalem. The scripture was 1 Kings 8, right? As we go down through Daniel now, back to Daniel. As we get down to verse 16, you know, they busted Daniel. They caught him praying. They caught him. They trapped him. They got him. And they brought him before the king. So the king, in verse 16, gave the command, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of pussycats. The den of Mickey's and Callie's, no? Mm-mm. Lions. Lions. And the king spoke, saying to Daniel, your God, whom you serve continually, nonstop, continually, he will deliver you. Isn't that interesting? That this man recognized that Daniel's God was the one true living God. And Daniel's God was real. And Daniel's God answered Daniel's prayers. Thus, obviously, Daniel's God is going to rescue him. Amen? The God that you serve continually, right? And they put the stone on. They locked him in. In verse 18, now the king went out the next day from his palace. Well, he went to his palace. And he spent the night fasting and praying for Daniel. Wouldn't it be great to know that the top spiritual leader and maybe governmental leader of this nation is praying for you? Wouldn't that be an honor and a privilege? Well, that's what excellence does. It brings you to that place where you are honored before kings or presidents. And then the sleep went for him. Then the king arose very early in the morning and went in haste to the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried out with lamenting voice to Daniel. The king spoke, saying to Daniel, "Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you serve continually, been able to deliver you from the lions?" Then Daniel said to the king, "O king, live forever. For my God sent his angels and shut the lion's mouth, so that they have not hurt me, because I was found innocent before God. And also, O king, I have done no wrong before you." Amen. So through this whole thing, not only was he innocent in the eyes of God, but he basically told the king, "The law you passed doesn't apply. I'm innocent before you," which means he had to cancel that. Well, it was only 30 days anyway, but. So, coming down to verse 25. Then King Darius wrote, "To all people and nations and languages that dwell on the earth, peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men must tremble and fear before the God of Daniel." Amen. How would you like your boss to set a new policy in the company because of the God you serve? Because of the integrity and the representation of the kingdom of God, that you will not cheat, you will not lie, you will not steal, you come in early and you stay late and you don't complain about it, you do your job and you don't just look busy because the boss is coming. You're truly a man and woman of integrity. How would you like your boss to honor you in such a way that they change the policy for everyone else? That's what happened. God says he's not a respecter of persons, people. But here's the thing. You need to walk with an excellent spirit. You need to know that if the bus leaves at 9, 9:05 is not good enough. And you need to know that if Noah's going to shut the door on that ark at a certain time, that you need to be inside the ark. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. So he said, you got to come and tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God, a steadfast forever. His kingdom is one which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall endure forever. Verse 27, he delivers and rescues, and he works signs and wonders in the heavens on earth, who has delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Amen? Amen? Now, it's very interesting what happened to Daniel's accusers. The ones who found fault in him. I find it very interesting that the king threw them to the lions. But not only them, but also their children to the lions. And the Bible says that even before they got to the bottom, their bones were all broken. Well, Pastor, why did they throw the children in too? The king wanted to make sure that that lineage of evil was dead. That generational thing would not continue. He was protecting his kingdom, right? Now we have to be like Daniel. Daniel was loyal to King Darius, but his loyalty was even greater to God. God is personal, and he hears the prayers of his people. Other characteristics of the prayer-hearing God in the chapter is, number one, he is a personal God to Daniel, and he hears and answers prayers. He is the living God. We just said it twice. He's able to deliver his people. We just said it. And God endures forever, according to verse 26. And that he is the God of Daniel. Amen? So we need to be like Daniel in our diligence. We need to step up our prayer life. We need to step up our spiritual life. We need to do, like, even as God even used Melissa, you know, to reach out to the people of our neighborhoods, to show forth the love and be determined to demonstrate the love and power of God to those that need to know God's love. God has called you and equipped you to be an agent of that love. You have a gifting and a calling upon your life. You know, you need to be passionate about your relationship with God. And as a leader, if you're not passionate about God, it makes your leaders go like this. Well, I'm not sure you really know God. You know, one of the things I always kind of struggled with in some degree is when people turn their backs on God and they walk away from God. And God spoke to me, you know, many years ago about it, kind of, you know, kind of in a sad kind of a way, brought peace to the situation. And he said, those who are intimate with me never leave me. So we need to come to the place now where we're starting to step up to the plate. And in ministry, as well as in your personal lives, those of you that are husbands need to be excellent in being a husband and a leader over your home. Those of you that are wives need to be excellent wives. Those of you that are children, and we're all children, right? Need to be excellent children, obeying our parents, you know? Those of us that call ourselves Christians need to represent Christ on our jobs. We need to represent Christ in our actions, and more importantly, in our reactions. In your reactions. You know what a reaction is? Somebody does something to you, you do something right back. Right, you love them, right? Somebody keys your car, you go out and you give them a big hug, say, I love you. Right? Or you want to lay hands on them. You know, like Dennis Tenorino said, you want to give them the fivefold ministry. Right? You know? When your day is perfect, you need very little faith. It's when the trials come. It's going to reveal who you really are in Christ, how strong you are in Christ, how good are you at resisting temptation. Amen? Reading the Word, study the Word to show yourself approved, prayer life, changing things. You have to do it, man. You have to do it. We need to be diligent. Amen? So next Sunday when we come in, 9:30, the place should be packed. Right? Because we're diligent people. And lack of diligence really is a choice. What's the big deal of setting your alarm 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes earlier? What's the big deal? You think those 15 minutes of sleep are really going to help you? Unless you think it's beauty sleep. I got news for you. It's not working. It's a joke. Joke. All right? It's more important to be planted and rooted in the house of God than to be sloppy about your walk with God. Amen? How many received this message this morning? Well, give the Lord a praise. Come on. Hallelujah. Now, if you're here this morning or you're watching by way of the Ustream, I have good news for you. God wants to prosper you. God wants to see you walking in health. More importantly, God wants to have relationship with you. Jesus died because he loved you. And even if you were the only person on earth, he would have chose to come and die for you to pay the penalty for your sin, so you could have restoration in your relationship with your Heavenly Father. Right now, if you've never given your life to the Lord Jesus, I have good news. It's not a big, hard thing to do. It's simple faith in believing that Jesus loves you and he died for you and he rose again victorious. If you just pray with me this very simple prayer, just say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Fill me with your Spirit. I acknowledge you as my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Now give me the desire to know you. Make it so I can hear your voice. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for healing me. And thank you for making me your child. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now if you prayed that for the first time, there's a phone number on the screen. Call that phone number. I'll be more than happy to speak with you, send you a Bible, teach you how to use that Bible. If you live in the area, come visit us. Find yourself a teaching church that's going to teach you faith and walking according to the Word of God, how to have victory in your life. If you don't live in the area, still call me. I will help you find that church. It's very important. God bless you. Thanks for tuning in. Amen. Did you receive this morning? Amen. Now be honest.